So today's speaker is His Grace Ram Gadadi Prabhu. So Prabhuji will enlighten us on Chaitanya Charitamrita. So Prabhuji, are you present on the call? Hare Krishna.
And managing those things is not very straightforward.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, are you present?
Yes, Mataji. Hare Krishna, can you hear me?
Yes, Prabhuji, now we can hear you. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, Dhanvat Pranam, all glories to Srila Prabhupada and Guru Maharaj. So, Prabhuji, now you can take over the class. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Jaya Jaya Shri Chaitanya Jaya Nityananda. Jaya Dvaita Chandra Jaya Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Jaya Jaya Shri Chaitanya Jaya Nityananda. Jaya Dvaita Chandra Jaya Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. So today we are reading from Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Leela, chapter 20, text number 100 onwards. The chapter title, Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu instructs Sanatana Goswami in the science of the Absolute Truth. Text 100. Apanara hita hita kichu na jani, gramya vyavahare pandita tai satyamani. Translation. I do not know what is beneficial for me or what is detrimental. Nonetheless, in ordinary dealings, people consider me a learned scholar and I am also thinking of myself as such. Text number 101. Kripa kari yadi more kari yacha udhara. Apana kripa te ha kaha kartavya amara. Out of your causeless mercy, you have delivered me from the materialistic path. Now, by the same causeless mercy, please tell me what my duty is. Text 102. Ke ami kene amaya jare tapatraya, iha nahi jani. Kemane hita hayam. Who am I? Why do the threefold miseries always give me trouble? If I do not know this, how can I be benefited? Purport. The threefold material miseries are miseries arising from the body and the mind, miseries arising from dealings with other living entities, and miseries arising from natural disturbances. Sometimes we suffer bodily when we are attacked by a fever. Sometimes we suffer mentally when a close relative dies. Other living entities also cause us misery. There are living entities born of the human embryo, of the eggs, perspiration and vegetation. Miserable conditions brought about by natural catastrophes are controlled by the higher demigods. There may be severe cold or thunderbolts, or a person may be haunted by ghosts. These threefold miseries are always before us and they entrap us in a dangerous situation. Padam padam yat vipadam. There is a danger in every step of life. So we will discuss these three verses today. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Sunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare Hare. So today we are reading from Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Lila, chapter 20, text number 100 to 102. So Sanatana Goswami is now talking to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Yes. Can your voice get a little louder, Prabhu? It's very, very low.
How about now?
Yes, this is good.
Okay. Mahaprabhu is now speaking to... Mahaprabhu spoke to Sanatana Goswami and he appreciated Sanatana Goswami about his renunciation and his eagerness to take a very humble position. And after Mahaprabhu gave his appreciation, then Sanatana Goswami is now speaking. So he put a straw in his mouth and bowed down to Mahaprabhu, and he clasped Mahaprabhu's lotus feet, and the verses that we read today are spoken by Sri Sanatana Goswami. So from these three verses, we are going to have three sets of reflections and some very interesting conversation, because these are all some basics of Krishna consciousness which we generally claim that we know, but then when we analyze deep, we are definitely getting to realize it's a long way to go. So in the next 45 minutes, let's analyze these three verses to definitely help us and learn some lesson to put it in practice. Some of the points that we may discuss have already been discussed in maybe long time before, maybe in a year before. One of the sessions that I took a year before, I had shared these points, some of the points. So maybe for some of you must have heard them before, it'll be just a kind of a revision, but it's very relevant to this context. So when Sanatana Goswami approached Mahaprabhu, there is something very unique that he is presenting. And this uniqueness is a very important quality that will help us in our devotional life. So what is he doing? He says, I do not know what is beneficial for me or what is detrimental. Nonetheless, in ordinary dealings, people consider me a scholar, and I am also thinking of myself as such. So this statement is not something which is commonly heard of in our own materialistic circle, because in the materialistic walks of life, we have a propensity where we try to consider ourselves that we know everything. Even if we know for an extent that we may not be fully cognizant, we do not want others to know that we don't know. Even if we are in a position to say that we don't know, we are also not in a position to be rectified, because we have various reasons. We rationalize that I actually would have known this, but the reason that I am not knowing today is because various reasons, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that. So Sanatana Goswami is educating, and this is not only Sanatana Goswami. If you see across the board, whoever had approached the Lord, whoever had approached Vaishnavas, whoever had shown us the path of process of Krishna consciousness, they have demonstrated this. The sages of Naimisharanya, when they met Suta Goswami, they are also putting some set of questions. And they are putting some set of questions for the welfare of the society, not for some, you know, worldly agenda. When Sanatana Goswami is asking, he is very categorically saying here that I may not know what is beneficial for me and what is detrimental. So our first reflection is, in our spiritual journey, self-evaluation and being self-honest is very important Because in the general world, we say we are not supposed to tell a lie to a lawyer, to an auditor, to a doctor, to a teacher. And if you tell some incorrect information to any one of them, then the problem is not for them, the problem is for us. So we need to be bold enough, we need to be matured enough in such a way that we can do self-evaluation. The reason I am saying bold enough is because when we take this agenda of analyzing ourselves, we feel either bored or feel somewhere that complacency within us not let us do that. Take an example that you are given a two tasks. Task number one, that we need to analyze ourselves and decide where do we stand. Task number two, we need to do that of somebody else. So it is quite but natural that we will do for somebody else pretty enthusiastically and with all our heart, all our love, all our devotion, all our emotion, all our sincerity, we will go and analyze and try to help them how they can practice Krishna consciousness nicely. And when it comes to our own selves, we have a very serious problem of overconfidence that we will be patting on our back, saying that, don't worry, you're intelligent enough, somehow things are not working now, it'll be all right. We will definitely come out of it. I will quote a very nice song of Bhaktivinod Thakur. This song is called Vidyara Vilase. It's not very, you know, regularly sung in a general Vaishnava bhajans, but it's a fantastic song, exactly in line with the same mindset that Sanatana Goswami is herein. Bhaktivinoda Thakur is singing, Vidyara Vilase Kata Inu Kala Parama Sahase Ami Tomara Charana Nabajinu Kabu Eko Na Sharana Tumi. With great enthusiasm, I spent my time in the pleasures of mundane learning and never worshipped your lotus feet. O Lord, now you are my only shelter. Use this adjective, great enthusiasm, which exactly fits into our lifestyle. When we are in the association of worldly-minded people, think of yourself meeting your classmates. Think of yourself meeting your college mates. Think of yourself meeting your office colleagues whom you have not met quite a while. With great enthusiasm, great eagerness, great involvement, great participation, we try to, you know, spend our lifetime, moments with them or sometimes our own family, near, dear ones. We spend so much of time in such a way that we think this is the end of the life. Then he goes further. Podite, podite, barasa barilo, yane gati habe mani. Reading on, my hopes grew and grew. For I considered the acquisition of material knowledge to be life's true goal. How fruitless those hopes turned out to be, for all my knowledge proved feeble. Now I know that all such erudition is actually pure ignorance. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur is classifying exactly what Sanatana Goswami have come to. Before coming to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Sanatana Goswami was a governor. It's up there in the position and the ranking in terms of intelligence, in terms of salary, in terms of, you know, power, fame, followers, assets. Sanatana Goswami was very, very famous. But then what position that he has assumed?
as a mendicant, as a humble beggar, Sanatana Goswami is standing in front of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So in our journey of Krishna consciousness, there are two things that are, you know, relevant from here. One is, you may have to be definitely self-honest and have a self-evaluation. And with that self-honest and self-evaluation, when you are approaching a bona fide source, don't give or don't let us not present. Let's keep aside at home or wherever you want all our so-called material acquisition and go there as a simple, humble, dependent devotee so that we will be able to receive the advice. So holding the straw in the teeth, Sanatana Goswami is keeping all the other cautions aside and trying to glorify and trying to surrender to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Bhaktivinoda Thakur goes further. He says, all the so-called knowledge of this world is born of the flickering potency of your illusory energy, Maya. It is an impediment to the execution of devotional service to you. Indulgence in mundane knowledge verily makes an ass of the eternal soul by encouraging his infatuation with this temporary world. So he says, our attachment towards this world is an infatuation. And we definitely agree this. We definitely have complete concurrence to this. That's the reason we are hearing Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. I'm sure all of us in this forum have that sincerity to hear Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita because we want a solution to come out of this. So what I wanted to bring it here is, it is important that we need to come to this understanding, come to this shoes of self-evaluation, self-honesty and self-confession. Because the more we hide about ourselves, problem multiplies. Hiding the problem multiply the problem. Confessing the problem divide the problem. But confession should not be done to anybody and everybody. Confession should be done to a person to whom we have respect, who is definitely situated in a position by which he can help us, and at the same time that person should have connection to the entire parampara, by which it is not somebody's individual opinion, it is about the sastric references that he or she quotes. So in our journey of Krishna consciousness, this confession, self-confession, is a very important agenda. And for self-confession, we need to be self-honest. And for self-honest, we need to do self-evaluation. So it's called honest, guided introspection that we always talk about. Now, we want to give a tool how to introspect, because introspection is a pretty tough agenda. So we have devised a tool. We have devised a small matrix, some set of easy tests that we can put to yourself by which we can assess ourselves. So I want to share this tool by which each and every one of us can measure this. In fact, we have gone ahead and did a mathematical analysis of this tool to give a quantitative results of whether I am in the, you know, green zone or a red zone or a black zone or a yellow zone. So, but anyway, we will not go to that analysis in the call. But I think I can share those parameters which has to be analyzed as your part of self-analysis. And based on this, we can analyze where do we stand and confess. Sanatana Goswami is giving his basis. The song that I just read, Bhaktivinoda Thakur is putting a basis on which why he feels he is very, you know, needing the mercy and how he is lowly situated. Of course, they are using their example to teach us, but then at least they are letting us know how to do this exercise of self-analysis and self-evaluation. So there are six parameters. Parameter number one that it needs to be looked at is about enthusiasm. So if this enthusiasm is not based on external parameters, this enthusiasm should be based on internal parameters, then we are in the devotional journey. Sometimes enthusiasm is because of some external parameters. I'm getting rewarded, I'm getting benefit, I'm getting compensated, I'm getting some followers. It's called enthusiasm derived out of external. If you see all the people out there in the world doing musical concerts, who are doing political speech, who are doing successful businesses, they are also enthusiastic, but they are enthusiastic with the reason. We are also enthusiastic with the reason, but not an external reason. Enthusiastic because we want to somehow or other go closer to Krishna. So if you see the enthusiasm, Sanatana Goswami, you know, shown, that enthusiasm is coming in the form of self-confession. The enthusiasm is coming in the form of a query. So, number first point is enthusiasm. The second aspect of self-analysis is about the service attitude or attachment to one's service. We are not just an event organizer. We need to remember that. Because most of the time, we are so perfect in putting certain things, putting up a Janmashtami, putting up... We are not event organizers. Even event organizers does this very efficiently. We are servant of the Lord. Hence, the service attitude and attachment towards the service that we execute is very important. So what is an attitude? With enthusiastic, with gratefulness, with humility, a service needs to be executed in full focus. The third parameter which needs to be taken up into consideration for self-analysis, self-evaluation, is about cooperation while doing service and cooperation between different services. We might be enthusiastic, we might also be attached to our service, but if we are not cooperative within the service or between the services, then we are still a Kanishta there. So it is extremely important that we need to develop a sense of cooperation, and multiple services need to coexist. It is very interesting that in the journey of Krishna consciousness, Krishna definitely gives a personal attention to us, even though thousands of devotees serve him. It is like in Rasalila, Krishna was dancing with all the gopis simultaneously, and he also gave a feeling to every gopi that he is dancing only with them. In devotional service also, we need to remember that Krishna is kind enough. It is not Krishna is kind only to you. Krishna is kind to everybody. But to each of them, Krishna is giving a personal attention and giving a assurance and feeling that he is with you and only for you. So hence, we need to remember that we need to cooperate and don't consider my service as the only best service in the world. Others are not so important. And the fourth parameter that helps us is questioning and asking question on application and periodically reflecting and checking if the above is happening, which means enthusiasm, service attitude, cooperation. So in your journey of Krishna consciousness, if you have never ever got any questions, you may not have asked because the forum doesn't allow, you may not have asked because of shyness, you may not have asked because of fear, but if you never had a question, then there is something seriously wrong, because a question is a natural outcome of an interest in applying what you have heard. If you want to apply for a visa form, you want to apply for an position in a college, if you want to apply for a position in a job, then you have plenty of questions. But if you are applying Krishna consciousness, if you never had a question, it's very unusual. This is the fourth parameter. So these four parameters are good, important, and vital in our own analysis. But these four parameters are based on two foundational parameters about which we need to check. The fifth one, which is the foundational one, is about envy. When you are doing service, when you are cooperating among the service, if only one person in the group got rewarded, got the Maha Garland, got the blessings, what does your heartbeat say? It's saying a very happy moment, or does it say that, oh my God, I have not got that. I also did the equal amount of service. I am also interested in you know, receiving some mercy, but why I was not given? Maybe that Prabhuji is partial. Maybe that Maharaj is, you know, not very considerate. Maybe, you know, whatever. So this propensity in the heart tells again that we are Kanishta. So hence the fifth principle that we need to cross-check is absolute zero of envy within ourselves should be there. And the last point, the most point important foundation is how attentive are we in our chanting, and no compromise on that. And last Wednesday when we spoke about five important inattentiveness in chanting, five important reasons or, you know, inattentive chanting, categories of inattentive chanting. So our attentive chanting happens to be the basis. Now let us look at the whole thing in the reverse order. If I chant nicely, I am cleansed of envy. If I am cleansed of envy, I naturally have questions in my heart of how I can, you know, move progress in Krishna consciousness. When I have questions in my heart, naturally I tend to cooperate amongst my fellow members and be curious to do service. And in that cooperation, I am getting so much inspired about the service that I will be attached to the service and execute the service in the right attitude. And with that, my enthusiasm to practice Krishna consciousness remains up there. So my first part of the first reflection is to say that how these six variables are extremely important for our journey in Krishna consciousness in terms of self-confession, self-evaluation, and very importantly, how it is being self-honest is known. Management means doing things correct. Leadership means doing correct things. So sometimes we are very efficient in managing, but what is expected is not to do things right, doing right things. Because our Krishna consciousness is a very subtle aspect of it, and if we just hung up on the external aspects of Krishna consciousness and does not focus on internalizing, then we will have an issue. So the second aspect of the first reflection, the first aspect I said is that's about tools, which is what we discussed about 6 points. The second aspect is Sanatana Goswami is teaching us how this confessing is just going and expressing in a very first class manner. He's telling three things in his: you please let me know what is beneficial to me, you please also let me know what is detrimental to me. Please note, the reason I am not able to differentiate this is because I am already lost in the glorification that people tell about me, which I feel is true because of my amateurishness. So the second set of reflection, or the second point of the first reflection that I want to say is, as a sadhaka, we are also prone to commit mistakes. So hence, I would like to analyze that how there are different categories in the way we handle the mistakes and which category we should be in. So there are four categories. If one knows his mistakes and immediately repent and ready to rectify, at the same time never repent, he is very well situated, and that is the stage we are supposed to be in, and that is the stage that Bhaktivinoda Thakur is showing us by his prayers, that is what Sanatana Goswami is teaching by his behavior, and that is what Arjuna did it by his own behavior. So a person need to know his mistakes, need to know where does he stand, and immediately be ready to realize, repent, rectify, and never repeat. This is first class category. But there's a second class category. A person knows the mistake and repent for it, but he does not have the courage, does not have enough enthusiasm to work on rectifying. This is second category, which means I know where do I stand. I do repent about it, but I don't have courage, or I'm complacent that I do not work on rectifying them. The third category is a person who does not know his mistake and is really ignorant. And the fourth category is a person who knows the mistake but tend to cover up and give justification. So these are the four categories of mindsets. If you are in the first category, very nice, keep doing it. For sure, a day will come. We will be able to come out of
I request devotees to make sure that you're on mute when you're on the call, except the speaker. Please check your phone that everyone is on mute. Thank you, Hare Krishna.
So that's the first category. And the second category is that it's okay to be there, but then not for a long time. You have enough of time. We realize our mistakes, but somehow or other we need to, you know, move forward. The third category is that this person is an illusion. So if somebody, a sincere devotee, helps him, give a helping hand, this person can be cured. And fourth category is the worst category to be in when we start justifying our stance. So all the Goswamis, whenever they approached Mahaprabhu, Srila Prabhupada, Vaishnavas, we see across the board, Arjuna, Sanatana, you know, the sages of Naimisharanya, Prahlad Maharaj, Dhruva Maharaj, you take anybody, Chitraketu, take anybody, when they approached self-realized soul, they had very nicely accepted their position and also accepted their inability to do on their own and confessed them. And just that confession is enough to divide your problem, and rest of the journey is very easy. So this is my first reflection. So first reflection has two parts. First part is the tool that I said about 6 pointers. Second part is about the categories of mistakes. The second point that Sanatana Goswami is saying, out of your costless mercy, you have delivered me from the materialistic path. Now by the same costless mercy, please tell me what my duty is. So, we need to know that on our own, we will not be able to bring ourselves out of the cycle of birth and death. We won't be able to help ourselves out of it. So, Sanatana Goswami has very openly expressed his need. So, it is not something to hide. Sanatana Goswami openly expressed, it is only by your costless mercy you have delivered me from this materialistic path. This is about the first step of getting cured, which is appreciation and glorification of our superiors and fellow devotees. In the sense that we are removing our judgmental, you know, specs and wearing our spectacles of being appreciative and glorifying them in a very full-hearted manner, not from our lip service. So Sanatana Goswami did that by his own conduct, and when he did that, it is very clear that he is single-pointedly focused to get Mahaprabhu's mercy and eager to learn from the Supreme Lord. So this happens to be a gate, chavi, key to open the doors of our heart, which is locked for spiritual knowledge. So when I say, my dear Lord, my dear Vaishnava, my dear Prabhupada, my dear devotees, that you are so great, you are so nice, and you please help me. One devotee asked this morning in the Bhagavatam class that I was giving in Houston Temple, said, how do I know I am serving Vaishnavas properly? So my response was that, if you are not judgmental, if you are serving Vaishnavas, don't judge. Serve everybody. Of course, you need to know how to serve them. You need to serve a Kanishtha differently, you need to serve a Madhyama differently, you need to serve a Uttama differently. But then, you need to serve and not judge. Judgment is also a service for somebody specifically to whom this has been entrusted upon. And the second is, when I am serving, I remember that I am serving not for my personal pleasure, it is for the pleasure of Srila Prabhupada. So even though we may not have personal benefit out of this service, we still serve because it's our duty. Srila Prabhupada asked Brahmananda Prabhu to go to Pakistan to go out and preach. Brahmananda Prabhu said that, Srila Prabhupada, I don't know anything in Pakistan. I've never been there. I don't know the language. And the country has a different religion altogether. You're asking me to go out and preach. Srila Prabhupada encouraged, no, you should go out and preach. And the result is that wonderful preaching outcome. He gave a report from there. Harikesh Maharaj was personal secretary of Srila Prabhupada. When he was doing personal service to Srila Prabhupada, in those days, being a personal secretary to Srila Prabhupada means very, very special position. Then, one day Prabhupada called him and said that you should go to Germany and preach. So Harikesh Maharaj asked Srila Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada, if I had made any offenses, please forgive me. If I have done any, anything that is not supposed to be done, please, help me to learn. I want to stay with you. And Srila Prabhupada said, no, I'm ordering you to go there. With full reluctance, with a heavy heart, Harikesh Maharaj went to Germany. Within few months, there was an annual Gaur Purnima festival in Mayapur. Harikesh Maharaj came with the books of Srila Prabhupada, translated in German language, and gave it as an offering to Srila Prabhupada during the Gaur Purnima festival. Srila Prabhupada said, you see, this is what I said, that if you work under the order of the spiritual master, what you can do. So my second realization, the second reflection that I want to say is that in the journey of Krishna consciousness, it is extremely important that we try to appreciate, glorify and submit. That is why I have an acronym for submit. Submit means surrender unconditionally our body, mind and intelligence in totality. So we surrender without any conditions, so no conditions apply. I am fully surrendering. What I am surrendering? My body, my mind, my intelligence. S-U-B-M-I-T. Surrender unconditionally body, mind, intelligence in total. So I am just surrendering my body, mind and intelligence, not just part. I may be saying that, Prabhu, I am surrendering. I may also be saying that I am unconditionally surrendering. But here it is said, in total. That is exactly what the episode that we just spoke last week. Srila Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said that, my dear Sanatana, I was also a bit concerned. I have already deliberately considered this matter. Since Lord Krishna is very merciful, He has nullified your attachment for materialistic things. Why should Krishna allow you to maintain a last bit of material attachment? So he was referring to Sanatana Goswami holding the woolen shawl, and when he gave up and accepted the quilt, then Mahaprabhu said this, that how that you are supposed to be giving everything in total. And he further says it is contradictory to practice Madhukari and at the same time wear a valuable blanket. One loses his spiritual strength by doing this and one will become an object of jokes. So the point here is that when we are in the process of Krishna consciousness, how we are appreciative, how we are serving and how we submit ourselves defines how efficiently we can do the first point about self-evaluation, self-honesty and confessing to a bona fide source. So this is my second reflection. The third point that I want to say is his set of questions. Who am I? Why do these threefold miseries always give me trouble? If I do not know this, how can I be benefited? You see, we just spoke about some components of progress in Krishna consciousness and what are the measurements to be tested. All of them are applied here by Sanatana Goswami. He is enthusiastic. He is very focused. He is asking questions. There was no envy. And he was constantly chanting the holy name. And of course, his service attitude and his collaborative working, you will see in the future, is very, very high. So, when Sanatana Goswami surrendered and asked, he did not ask some, you know, can you please explain about Radha and Krishna's personal, you know, relationship and how they... He didn't go any high stuff. He spoke basic stuff and he was focusing on making sure that he is properly situated. In our own spiritual journey, we also need to learn this, because what we theoretically know, we actually practically need to be evaluating. So if you think you are humble, put yourself in the humiliating situation. Expose yourself in the humiliating situation. If you think you are patient, put yourself in the perturbing situation. If we think we are tolerant, put yourself in a situation which bothers us. If we think we are very kind to people, put yourself in a situation where people are bothering you. So we generally think, we have our own assumption that how humble, how simple, how tolerant, how patient I am. But when after giving a Bhagavatam class, if I have to be in the Prasadam queue and somebody says, hey, stand in the queue in the last and come in the queue, that's when your humility is tested. When somebody does not cooperate with you, that's when your patience is tested. So the principle that I am saying is, in our journey of Krishna consciousness, we need to ask questions that are pertaining to application of Krishna consciousness in our life. And please understand that in our journey of Krishna consciousness, these questions are but natural if you do those six things. Of course, question is one of them, but the point is, if you do chanting and being non-envious, question is a natural outcome immediately after that. The reason why we don't get questions, that's my third reflection. If you analyze the root cause of why we don't get such questions, why we are not able to get there even after, you know, discussing so many instructions on this matter. We tell every day in the morning about the 10 offenses. It's about three important viruses. So those are hypocrisy, immorality, and violence. Hypocrisy, we have spoken in the past. Immorality, it's a very interesting point, because as devotees, we always think that morality is subservient to devotion. In one sense, yes. But the point is, instead of becoming transcendental to morality, we should have transcendental morality. And violence here referred does not mean slaughterhousing or beating or thrashing somebody. Violence means not having self-compassion, not being considering that you need to improve upon. So what we do is that we from Naradama to Mahatma, we directly do a jump. So we have different stages. From Naradama, lowest amongst the mankind, you first come to a human being category. From human being category, you come to a gentleman category. From gentleman category, we go to Mahatma category. And in this process, there are some basics that we need to, you know, have in place. And for doing that basics, we discussed in the past how our sadhana is important. And the way the sadhana needs to be important is in a consistent manner. We spoke about the acronym SEEK. How we need to be very, very consistent. So if there is absolute need that our basics of Krishna consciousness need to be in place in a consistent way. So this Naradama to Mahatma jump, amateurishly, will put us in trouble. This Naradama to Mahatma category will put us in trouble. But if you see these three viruses that I spoke about, hypocrisy, immorality, and violence, put them together, it's HIV, a big virus, HIV positive, then we have a disease called AIDS. And what is AIDS for us? We acquire inadequate devotional symptoms. So we have this disease of AIDS because of this HIV positive is our root cause why we are not able to understand Krishna consciousness And Sanatana Goswami is directly hitting that point. And this is the first question that he is asking. Many more questions he is going to ask, and Mahaprabhu is going to give a fantastic stroke on the advices and instructions, which you will see in this chapter. So who am I? First I should know who am I. We have heard about this. If anybody giving a class about I'm not this body, spirit, soul, we consider that class as a very basic class. Suppose I say in this lecture that all the South Indian people are, you know, crazy and egoistic people. All the people who are South Indian hearing in this class may have a feel, hey, I'm South Indian, Prabhuji is referring something about South Indian bad. So if we still consider ourselves with our race, we still consider ourselves with our creed, community, caste, color, even though we may have heard about it, we may have got our Devadasi, Dasi initiated names, we still have our identification with respect to our body. So that is why, you know, Prabhupada explained, the miseries of this body and the dangers of our life is inevitable, and hence the first question in our life should be always to come out of that. That's the basic. If that is not addressed, how do you go and even understand any higher subject matter? So the root cause of why things are not happening and why these questions are not coming in is because of we are HIV positive and we are affected with this disease of inadequate devotional symptoms. But I have just did an analysis that this is pretty clear, Prabhu, but I hear Bhagavatam, I hear do services, I understand I'm not supposed to be hypocritic, I'm not supposed to be, you know, unethical, I'm not supposed to be, you know, self-violent, but still it is happening. I'm struggling. Why? Where is the problem? Where do I need to go and look at it? Where do I need to go and improve upon? For that, there are five important reasoning that you can do. Those five reasonings are the root cause of the root cause. It is like Krishna says, sarva karana karanam. So similarly, we do analysis of what is the root cause of this root cause, which are number one, familiarity. Because of our practice in Krishna consciousness, we are familiar with holy name, we are familiar with Bhagavatam, we are familiar with deities, we are familiar with devotees, we are familiar with Siddhanta, and this familiarity breeds contempt. You can go on Google or you can go on Vedabase, search the word familiarity. More than 30 plus instances Srila Prabhupada has mentioned about this familiarity. The second reason is overconfidence. Third reason is our self-centered nature. Fourth is extended attachment to our ideologies. I am Brahmin, I am South Indian, I am a Sri Vaishnava, I am temple president, I am, you know, Bhakti Shastri, I am Bhakti Vaibhava, I am Bhakti Sarvabhauma. And you know what, in our own culture we don't do this. So many of our ideologies. And last but not least, basics is ignorance, because we have never done anything. We just heard and slept. So the point is that we should come out of Smashan Vairagya mode to a Yukta Vairagya mode. What is Smashan Vairagya mode? Whenever we are in the Bhagavatam class, whenever we are in the association of devotees, we have a very strong Vairagya. Yes, I won't do this. I will definitely get on to this and kind of. But the moment we leave the crematorium, it's like in the crematorium when we go, we have a, oh my God, life is this much only. Whatever I have done, it's all, you look at this guy. He was a very rich guy, very famous guy, very beautiful guy, and so on. So you look at this guy, he's now dead. Life is dead. So that's the Vairagya. We will be there in the Smashan. The moment we leave the Smashan Ghat, the crematorium, what happened to the Vairagya? So Prabhupada encourages us that we should give up the Smashan Vairagya. We should give up the market Vairagya. What is market Vairagya? Monkey renunciation. We jump from one branch to another branch. So neither Smashan Vairagya nor market Vairagya is going to help us. At least we should start with Yukta Vairagya. If Krishna has given you intelligence, please utilize them. If Krishna has given you assets, please utilize them. If Krishna has given you name and fame, please utilize them. And that's exactly what Srila Prabhupada did. And that's exactly every Vaishnava, every spiritual master will do upon their disciples, because they want to make sure that we get disconnected from all those things that we are attached to, and we just stay attached only to Krishna. So what I want to say is that as you move progress in Krishna consciousness, please don't expect a rosy path. Please don't expect a very interesting, you know, peaceful, serene journey. It is assured that the more you are going to surrender, more you will be challenged. The more you are going to surrender, more you will be tested. More you will be surrender, more you will be questioned to see, are you in the right place? And this is time and again proven in the Shastra. But yes, one assurance is that when those problems are coming, and if you are in the right path in our journey of Krishna consciousness, what happens is that we get a perspective to look at those challenges. We get an education that this challenge is a blessing, and we get matured enough that we go and thank Krishna, please give me more and more of this so that I can remember about you. Okay, Prabhuji, when we become self-realized soul, completely pure, then what? Then also, Krishna is going to use you for teaching others. At the same time, he is also going to use you to teach others how, in spite of this trouble, they are determined in serving me, and how I am always there to rescue them. So it is a very interesting journey of Krishna consciousness. Only first three lectures are free, where we will be given royal treatment. Prabhuji, have first time in Krishna consciousness, please go and collect your gift. Second lecture, oh Prabhuji, please come and have prasadam. Third lecture, oh very nice to have seen you here. Fourth lecture, Prabhuji, can you please broom that lobby area? Prabhuji, can you please wash this vessel? Prabhuji, can you do this? So if at all we are here in Krishna consciousness for some spiritual entertainment, we will always remain Kanishta. If we are interested in moving forward, we need to walk that path that Sanatana Goswami is demonstrating us. So hence, the third reflection is that we need to know to ask those set of questions and work on application of our Krishna consciousness. And application is very important. And if you do the first thing and second thing in order, you will know how to do the third thing properly. So Sanatana Goswami is a very good example for us to teach us how our Krishna consciousness needs to be, you know, organized. And what we are speaking now is not a rocket science. It is a science. Just that if we try to be very nicely focused, we will be making good progress. We come to Krishna consciousness out of curiosity, but we move in Krishna consciousness out of seriousness. So curious to serious is our journey. If you always remain curious, you will remain Kanishta. If you want to become serious, you definitely need to do these three things. Otherwise, padam padam yat vipadam natesham. Prabhupada writes that any one of the misery will devour us, and we will continue to suffer in this misery for life after life after life after life, and we will be the biggest unfortunate person in the world to have got everything with us but still lost the opportunity. I'll just end with a small point that it is very difficult in this world to know we are diseased, but if somebody know that, they are better off. If you have knowing the disease, to get to a right person who will cure is more difficult. But if you have known that also, you are much better off. Knowing that person, to reach him out is not so easy. But if you reach that person, is all the more better off. And if you get medicine from him, is all the more better off. So you found your disease, you found your physician, you met him, you are given a medicine, and you already purchased the medicine is in your hand. But all this endeavor will become Shramayavahi Kevalam if we don't consume it. So we will continue to stay in this material world and keep blaming different people for our not progressing in Krishna consciousness. I didn't progress because of this Mataji, I didn't progress because of that Prabhuji, I didn't progress because of my husband, because of my daughter, because of this, because of that. So there are so many examples how, because of every other problem, devotees in the Shastra example, they have further progressed. There's nobody more in this world who would have given trouble to Prahlad Maharaj than Hiranyakashipu, who would have suffered externally the trouble than Prahlad. But he has proved how Krishna consciousness works. Of course, it's an extreme ideal case, but at least if you want to take a real-time case in terms of our own context, Srila Prabhupada, he has gone through a very interesting phase, and all helped him is his single-pointed focus to serve the spiritual master's mission. So I would like to conclude by summarizing the three lessons that we learned today. First lesson is we need to be self-evaluating, being self-honest, and be compassionate to ourselves. And with that compassion, we should approach a bona fide spiritual master, bona fide devotee, and confess there. And as a part of that, for a part of the introspection, we said about 6 points. The points are: we need to have enthusiasm, we need to be attached to our service, we need to be cooperative in our service, we need to have some questions about application of our Krishna consciousness, we should be non-envious and be very attentive in the chanting. And the second set of points is that there are different categories in which mistakes are analyzed. Mistakes where we know our mistakes, we are already repenting about it, we are realizing about it, we are definitely interested in rectifying and not repeating it again. Second category is we realize, but at the same time we have complacency or some laziness in going to apply and rectify ourselves. The third is we are ignorant, so do not know if we are making mistakes or not. And fourth is we try to justify. The fourth category is never to be in. Third category is a person who should need some guidance. So if you found somebody in the category, go out and preach. And if you are in that category, go and take somebody's help. The second category is definitely a concern, but if you get a good helping hand, you take a necessary support from Vaishnavas, you can make a progress. And if you are in the first category, don't do anything, just be there. Krishna will take you, because Krishna know that we will make mistakes and improve upon. And the second reflection that we discussed is about how we need to express our appreciation and express our dependency to Krishna and Vaishnavas and surrender ourselves to them, because of our acknowledgement and appreciation and glorifying and doing some service under a bona fide source, we have a hope to progress in Krishna consciousness. And last but not least, that we need to be curious enough in applying Krishna consciousness and asking those questions by which we will be able to immediately dovetail our propensity in the service of the Lord. Hare Krishna, thank you so much. If there are any questions or comments, we can discuss. Any questions or comments?
Prabhu, Dhanat Pranam. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and Guru Maharaj.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, thank you so much. The whole class is so purifying, means it's a very, very instructive for me, myself, how we can, we are the main things when we are putting in that trouble situation. If you want to show humility, all these things, how you gave the example, and then we should be very intelligent to see what is our position right now, where we are. All these things, all the class was so instructive, and then thank you so much. So all the neophyte qualities, whatever I have, and then we think we are practicing Krishna consciousness, and dasi, like that. You were telling in the class, I mean, how we should be very much eager to move on, not only observe in Krishna consciousness, move on. I sincerely pray to you, Prabhuji, please bless to me, maybe I can move on, at least try to improve my quality in Krishna consciousness, not only say in observe in Krishna consciousness. And all the devotees also, I really sincerely pray to all of your lotus feet, and say, I really want to move in Krishna consciousness. And Prabhuji's class was very, very instructive. Means even though you were telling we are not this body, if we means point out in particular caste or country, if we point out, immediately rectify, try to rectify. Oh, why Prabhuji is telling like that? Means so many things we should be watching ourselves, means where we are in right now and how we need to go further. All these things you gave, all the every class, Prabhu, whenever you give the class, all the principle you give to us, it's a very, very instructive class, Prabhu. Thank you so much. Hope I can apply and take very seriously, Prabhu, all of your, by all of your blessing.
Thank you so much. Hare Krishna. Thanks for your good words.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Any other questions or comments?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam, all Goshala Prabhupada and Gurudev. Thank you very much for a wonderful association. Keep us in your prayer.
Hare Krishna. Any other questions or comments?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam, all Goshala Prabhupada. Thank you so much, Prabhuji. Thank you. As Mataji told, like the such an instructive class, and the most important thing that when we hear this, then we realize that yes, we are doing the same thing and we have to improve. So, because sometimes we forgot that our position is like this. So, thank you so much, Prabhuji, for at least when we will know we have to improve this, then only we can improve. So, thank you so much, Prabhuji, for such beautiful instructions. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, I have one question. Means when we try to improve ourselves, means what should be our prayers? Means we really want to improve ourselves, not only stay like this. Means we really want to improve whatever we are trying to do, but it's not our hand. Yes, so if Krishna also need to give all the intelligence like that.
Krishna understands English language, so whatever you just said, you just tell Krishna, that's all. So your prayer is what you just said a few minutes before. That's all. You just go and tell Krishna what you just told me. You just go and tell Krishna every day, consistently. It is said that when the chicken is in the nest, there are many chickens are there. When the mother comes, the mother will start feeding that chicken which is screaming a lot. Suppose in a room there are 20 kids and you have to, you know, settle them. Which kid you will first attend? The most noisy, kid, you say, hey, somehow let me attend them, because if he is quiet then I'll be okay. So it is said that in our devotional life we can make as much noise as we want to our mother and father, who is Supreme Lord, and our own, sort of Srila Prabhupada. The more the noise you make, the best attention that you get. So good luck to you. Hare Krishna.
Yes, Prabhu, yes. Thank you so much, Prabhu. Yes, okay. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Any other questions or comments?
Wonderful, wonderful class, Prabhuji. Wonderful question. Instructions and also the answers. Very nice. Thank you very much, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Okay. So if there are no questions, then we can end the class.
Yes, Prabhuji. Yes, we can conclude our class. वांछा सकल विषय कृपा सिंधु एवचा पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः अनंत कोटि वैष्णवंद की जय श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय चैतन्य प्रभु की जय हिज ग्रेस राम गिरधारी प्रभु की जय तो थैंक यू सो मच प्रभु जी हरे कृष्ण
हरे कृष्ण